Hello everyone. In this video, we're going to look at visualizing flight status data that we get from an API using Python. We're going to be using Python in Jupyter Notebook. We're going to be using Pandas, and I'm going to show you how to normalize nested dictionaries. We're going to use normalize. We're going to use the normalize function. And let me show you what I've written so far. Flight data viz. Import JSON, import requests from .env, import load.env. If you've watched my previous flight tracker video, you'll see, I'll just show you. This is what I did in VS Code. I've moved over to Jupyter Notebook so we can do some visualization bits and pieces. So we can visualize the information that we're getting. One of the endpoints I found was flight status equals diverted, and I thought that would be quite an interesting thing to visualize. Where are the flights being diverted, and see if we can visualize a pattern that we would not otherwise see just by looking at the data. Obviously, that's the real benefit of data visualization. What we've got here, these two lines, which are to allow me to export as an HTML file, my visualization. I'm using Pretty Print. You'll see why in a second. .env, load.env, that's because I've got my API stored in a .env file. You don't have to do that. I'm just doing that because I'm showing my code to all of you. If one of you saw my API key, you could potentially use up all of my requests, and then I wouldn't be able to make any more videos for a week or so. That was a previous request. That was where I was getting aircraft types. You might have seen that in the first video if you've watched it. Right, today we are looking at diverted flights, as I just mentioned. So this URL, instead of aircraft types, we're using the endpoint flights. We're passing the access key, which is equal to flight API in curly braces, which is equal to os.getenv flight API, which we've loaded using load.env, which we is hard work, but it's foolproof. And they do say if you make something foolproof or idiot proof, they'll make a better idiot. Flight status equals diverted. We're getting diverted information. Information about diverted planes. Don't think it's helicopters. I wouldn't think so. So, first thing we do, that's not needed. With our response from our request, we say, I'll just show you this. API, in fact, what have I just done? Have I broken it? I may have broken it. I should put that back. Sorry. Let me run this from scratch. I'm just being conservative with my requests. So we'll just run the first cell. You see the star up here. It means it's running. Once that's complete. There we go. Right, now that's complete. The benefit of running in Jupyter Notebook is I don't have to make any more requests. So if I run this, there we go. So API underscore response, I create a new variable that is equal to API underscore result dot JSON. API underscore result dot JSON is the JSON of the response that I get back from the request. So the request sends back some JSON, and I'm telling this variable to, I'm saying, read it as JSON. Then, because it's JSON, I can then use that with my data frame. So I say data frame equals API response, square brackets, data. So then I'm just picking out, without that, I would have some more stuff. I'd have bits before the list. So it's still not a data frame yet. I'm just using the data frame nomenclature. What I do then is, so I pass it a little bit more. API response. In fact, because I've set the data frame to response data up here, I can get rid of that line. Right, this is the good bit. This is the what I think is very useful. I've had to do a challenge before. If you've ever done a job application for a software engineer job and they send you a challenge, sometimes you'll have to format data, do data pipelines and so on. I did that early part of this year. Lots of nested dictionaries. At the time, I was considering using JSON normalize. I don't think I could get it working for some reason. Probably lack of brain power. Bad. Right, let's look at this. So if I comment this out, and I'll show you the data frame, if we just do pd.dataframe. So the variable we've got at the moment, which is just basically it's just dictionary. If I just read that dictionary into a data frame and then do df, let's run that cell. This is this looks okay, but what have we got here? If I zoom in on this, can you see we've got flight date is fine, flight status is fine, aircraft. I don't know why that's none, but not worried about that for the time being. What I am worried about is why we've got within our cell, we've got another dictionary. So we need to, what we want is we want to get that value from that key. So this is where we'll change from doing pd.dataframe to pd.json_normalize, and then we pass in our variable called df, which is actually a dictionary. So just uncomment that. If we run this, keep an eye on departure. So departure at the moment has got a dictionary. If we run it again, we've got that's not what was supposed to happen. Right, let's just run this again. There we go. It's because with pandas, I always call it pandas. Does anyone else called Jupyter call it pandas? Right. Do you see now we have departure airport? Before we had the dictionary, now we've got departure airport. So what it's done is it's actually gone into the departure dictionary, and then it's gone into the airport dictionary, which was inside the departure dictionary. I can prove that to you here. Do you see how we've got departure? Oh, sorry, departure is the key. Then we've got this, all of this as down to here is a value. Now that value we don't want to, that value in a pandas cell is no good to us. So by doing departure dot airport, pandas is actually converting that, it's getting the value from departure dot departure airport. So what we've now got is a list of departure time zones and departure airports. So if we put those two bits of information together and we import plotly.express as px, from plotly import graph objects as go, not to be confused with the Go programming language. Then the usual, so if you've watched my other video where I do some data analytics on my YouTube channel, you may have already seen this. Fig means figure equals px, that's plotly express. Plotly express dot scatter, so we're using the scatter method from plotly express. We're passing in our data frame. The X, so the horizontal, is the departure time zone. On the vertical, we've got the departure airport. The title, so that's just text. The hover data, I've decided to use the airline name. And fig.update underscore traces mode equals markers. I always use that. I can't remember why. In fact, let's run it without and I'll just see what it breaks. Oh, yeah, that's not good. Yeah, so that's why I use it. put that back in. And that's gone really... Oh, it's because I've zoomed in so much, sorry. This is a strange thing about Jupyter. Sometimes when you zoom in, things actually get smaller. And in fact, that's not what I had just now. Let me zoom out. And let's just run this again. Auto scale? No. Zoom. How bizarre. That is not what I had just now. Was it because let's try this some. We'll get there in a second. I think that's about as good as we're going to get. So hopefully that's okay. That's readable. And what you can see is we've got the departure airport and we've got the departure time zone. So if you tilt your heads, you've got all of these time zones along here. And we can see that this particular time zone has had lots of diversions. So departures, anything departing from America, New York, and you can see the airline name, Delta Airlines, Cape Air, NetJets, American Airlines, Spirit. So anything departing from New York has been diverted, or there's been lots, and also from Chicago has had a lot of diversions, and all the others just pretty much one, apart from Rome in Italy. So this is a really good way of visualizing data that you would never, it would be very, very difficult to spot this kind of pattern just from looking at the data. You could scroll through, but it would be, very difficult to spot. So what I've shown here is how to flatten all of this. So as before, the departure airport was nested inside. So San Francisco International was the value of the airport key, which was all of this was the value of the departure key. JSON underscore normalize. So this is how to use it. You pass in your data frame, you do pd.json underscore normalize, and if you've got a JSON response from requests.get, all you need to do is just pass out the relevant piece. For instance, if I hadn't passed out data, let me just comment those two out and I'll just show you what we would have otherwise had. If I'd just had API response, run that, we would have had this as well. We would have had pagination, limits, and this would have really messed up the data frame even more. So what I did was I picked out data as the key, and then once that was the key, then I had all of these values, which is what I want. Pagination is, that's just telling you how many results you're getting per request, and you've got 766 there, so potentially 766 diverted flights. We could do a while loop, or we could keep getting more and more. I think 100 is okay just to get started with. Really, the focus of this is to be able to use JSON underscore normalize. And you see, you get the column names are actually the initial key followed by the initial value. And obviously, this goes way off the edge of the screen. You can do set max width, pd dot set max column width to 1,000 if you want, max number of columns, and then you just end up scrolling all the way across, a bit like this. Got lots of not of numbers there. I don't know if that was because there was stuff missing. Departure terminal, departure gate. I guess a lot of this information. Oh, live longitude, live latitude. Well, there you go. So that's how to do a scatter plot of some flight data. Hope it's been interesting. If you haven't learned anything else, just remember that you can flatten some nested dictionary using pandas with pd.json underscore normalize. And remember to use that. There's an older version, and you'll get a deprecated warning message if you do it the other way, which is, I've forgotten what that was, but you'll get the pink rectangle with the black writing telling you that it's going to be deprecated. So yeah, update it, use the newer version. It's simpler syntax, so why not? Catch you in the next video. Thanks for watching. Thumbs up, subscribe, and all that. Thank you very much. And see you next time.